The Pacific coast of South America is part of the so-called Pacific Ring of Fire. The name is a result of the high volcanic and seismic activity that surrounds the Pacific Ocean in the east, north and west. This is a direct result of plate tectonics. Subduction zones transport fluids into the upper Earth mantle, and in combination with the frictional heat, melted material rises to the surface in form of volcanoes. At the same time, these zones bear a high potential for large earthquakes. Ecuador is part of the Ring of Fire, and it is frequently struck by major earthquakes. Since 1900, 6 subduction earthquakes with magnitudes greater than 7 have occurred. The latest large event took place on 16 April 2016 offshore the west coast of central Ecuador and had a magnitude of 7.8. The investigation of its occurrence properties and aftershock sequence can lead to a better understanding of the tectonic processes and can help to estimate a potential seismic hazard. Hello and welcome. In this video, you will learn how seismic data of earthquake aftershocks can help to better understand and characterize earthquake activity. I will introduce you to Sergio Leon Rios, who investigated aftershocks of the Ecuador earthquake in 2016. He will show you how he installed seismic stations to observe the aftershocks, and you will learn how he analyzed the data to obtain an accurate picture of the spatial earthquake distribution. Sergio also determined earthquake source mechanisms, and you will see how these, together with the localizations, characterize the rupture plane of the main shock. This leads to a better understanding of the local tectonics at the Ecuadorian Pacific coast. The major earthquake of 16 April 2016 had a magnitude of 7.8, corresponding to a rupture size of approximately 100 times 40 kilometers. It occurred as a result of a fast block displacement in the megathrust fault where the Nazca oceanic plate subducts beneath the South American plate. Here, the convergence between both plates shows an eastward direction and a relative velocity of about 6 cm per year. Over 600 people died and over 8,000 were injured in this devastating earthquake. Aftershock activity held on for several months with magnitudes of up to 6.9. Sergio Leon Rios analyzed seismic records of these aftershock data to study how those events were related to the main shock and how this knowledge can improve seismic hazard estimations. Hi Sergio.
Hey, hello.
After the 2016 earthquake, you installed temporary stations to monitor as many of the immediately starting aftershocks as possible. Who participated in this deployment and how were the stations distributed?
Okay, yep. All reaction was pretty quick after the earthquake. And we joined in a large collaboration project that involved the Geophysical Institute of Ecuador, plus France, US, and the United Kingdom. Just 2 weeks after the main shock, the first team was already deploying stations in the affected area. The British team and me joined them 1 month after the earthquake. The maps show you the temporary stations that were deployed with an in-between spacing of 20 kilometers around the ruptured area. Ours are plotted in red, the ones from the US in green, and the permanent Ecuadorian network stations in yellow. We were always thinking the temporary stations to act as a complement for the permanent network. Later, at the end of May, the ocean bottom seismometers, or OBSs, here in blue, were installed by the French team, and finally we got this beautiful array to record the entire aftershock sequence. This was only possible with the collaboration of many countries and institutions.
So the seismometers enhanced the existing permanent station network. How could this improve the localization of the aftershock seismicity?
Yeah, for sure they did. The more stations we have, the better the localizations we will get. With this array, we could surround the earthquakes and improve their original localization. Here, the role of the OBSs was very important. It gave us more coverage that helped us to better control the depth, but also to reduce the azimuthal gap caused by the lack of instruments in the Pacific Ocean. The azimuthal gap is the maximum angle that is not covered with seismometer observing an earthquake. And as you can see here in the figure, it is well covered for our study case. This network allows us to have a lot of data in terms of phase arrival time. You can see one example here. The PNS waves arrive later when increasing the epicentral distance. With those travel time data of more than 200 earthquakes, we inverted for the earthquake hypocenter and a minimum 1D model. This model is the representation of the underground structures that explain the travel time data best. This is the 1D model we obtained from the observed data. The PNS wave velocities increase with depth. You can see that major steps are at 10 and 40 kilometers. The localization procedure hence finds the lowest residual between observed and modeled travel time data. This methodology improved previous earthquake locations by solving the structure and localization problem at the same time.
The main shock of the Pedernales earthquake took place on a very shallow dipping subduction zone. Is it the same for the aftershocks? Where exactly did they occur?
Well, yes, it's mostly the same for the aftershocks, but our localizations give us insight about the exact distribution of the aftershock sequence. Most of them are distributed along the plate interface, but we also found some crustal activity in the overriding plate. In general, the distribution shows some streaks perpendicular to the trench. Also, the aftershock with magnitudes greater than 4 occur outside the rooftop area of the main shock, and they even reach up to the trench. This is something not common in subduction margins, where typically a seismic accretionary prism filled with sediments are formed around the trench. And another important thing to highlight here is the area without earthquakes, something that seems to be a common behavior in this region. But it still remains under discussion what can be causing this.
If they are outside the slab, what may be the reason for their occurrence?
Well, after a large event like the 7.8 in Ecuador, the whole area needs to accommodate the stress. One way to do it is by releasing energy in places that were not affected by the main rupture. Therefore, earthquakes may be triggered in the outer rise, close to the trench, or in the overriding plate.
Okay, but some of the source mechanism occurred within the slab. Does that mean that they had a similar source mechanism as the shallow thrusting main shock?
Well, yes. Most of the aftershock occurred there in the seismogenic area, and therefore they will have a similar mechanism as the main shock. If we go into the figure, you see that the majority of aftershocks shows fault planes parallel to the plate interface. It has a dip between 15 to 20 degrees, and this orientation can also be identified with the rupture plane of the main shock. However, we also found some extensional and strike slip events that call for our attention. In our research, we proposed that extensional events can be related with the subduction of sediments that can generate normal faulting. For strike-slip seismicity, this could be associated to the friction caused by the subduction of a massive bathymetric feature, such as the carnate ridge, coming from the oceanic crust.
So what can we learn from the aftershock distribution and their source mechanisms?
Well, the important thing here is to highlight that large earthquakes, like the one in Ecuador in 2016, can activate or reactivate other fault areas. This can trigger seismicity at shallow depths and with a different source type compared to the main shock. The good news about identifying those events with unexpected mechanism is that now we can include them as an actual threat and update the hazard map for the region.
Thanks. So here, science directly improves hazard estimation and possibly precaution procedures. What are you planning next?
Well, the next step for this research is to build a 3D tomography. The starting point of that will be to use the 1D model and the locations we obtained in this study. And of course, we need to incorporate more data, but we're getting there.
Thanks again and good luck for this.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
In this video, you learned how aftershock sequences are used to characterize active subduction. Sergio Leon Rios introduced you to the Ecuadorian subduction zone and showed you that the aftershocks of the 2016 earthquake mainly lie on the thrusting fault plane and thus show its seismic activity. Their mechanisms mainly show the actual plate motion. However, some aftershocks were different, showing the complexities that a subduction zone can have. Including that information into recent earthquake hazard modeling can improve regional hazard estimations and better prepare people and authorities for future earthquakes. Thank you.